is kind of magical, because like you're basically sticking this guy in a world and telling it almost nothing about the world, and he's trying to explore, and somehow, you know, occasionally he gets cookies and occasionally he gets bopped on the head. And over time, he's supposed to learn to get more cookies and avoid getting bopped on the head. So it's kind of amazing that it works at all, but it turns out that it does. And we'll sort of talk about approaches people use to address this problem. This is one of the, like, so this is sort of a generalization of machine learning, because we were with machine learning, you get to make one decision, and you get your training data, you make your decision, and you're done. Here, you're making a sequence of decisions over time. So RL is kind of built on top of MDPs. It's defined on top of the MDPs that we were talking about last time on Tuesday. And sort of before we get into that, I guess I wanted to talk, I had to skip over some slides last time about the cursive dimensionality in MDPs and different ways that people handle that. And that's, it's sort of a digression to some research that we're doing in my lab, but I think it's really relevant and interesting, because I was really frustrated when I started studying MDPs and RL, because like everybody seemed to be using the tabular representation. That's where we're enumerating the entire state action space, and we have an entry for every single thing. And it just seemed kind of inane. Like, why are we rolling things out like this? And it turns out it's easier to explain the math and a lot of the ideas when we use that rolled out representation, generalized to richer representations that capture more of what's going on in the domain. So I wanted to talk a little bit about that. So we're kind of moving beyond what's in the textbook and talking a little bit about what are some open research questions in this area, in MDPs and planning, and also in reinforcement learning. So I have this Minecraft video going because that's the domain that we're using to explore some of these problems. So in a lot of, like if you read the RL, there's an RL textbook that's on the web and that sort of goes through a lot of these algorithms that we're talking about. And it's really easy to get lost in algorithms. Like there's like, it's like kind of like an alphabet soup of, you know, Q learning and SARSA and you're going to do RMAX on the projects. And then if you read papers, like they'll start, like I was reading a paper just earlier to prepare for a lecture, and I was like, I hadn't even heard of three of the algorithms they were using as baselines. So there's a lot of different ways of remixing what we're doing to solve MDPs and to solve reinforcement learning. And they, almost all of them, though, kind of build off of the Bellman equation that we were talking about last time in different configurations. So we're going to keep coming back to that as giving structure to what we're going to be talking about. So the problem when you have situations like Minecraft and you can actually place blocks in different places in the world, so the way that a conventional, people call this the tabular representation, where you're just going to roll out every single state space. The way that the tabular representation will represent Minecraft is that the state where I stuck the block, let's say I've stuck it in, you know, this corner, is completely unrelated to the state where I stick the block in this corner. Okay? So when we're doing our value iteration updates and estimating the utility of those two states, those estimates are completely unrelated. And similarly, when we're doing reinforcement learning, where we're trying to learn this from samples, how the world looks when we've got the block over here versus over here, the algorithm isn't able to generalize between those two situations. Does that make sense to everybody, why that won't happen? So we're just going to have an entry in our matrix for this state. This is going to be state number 230, and this is going to be state number 231. And even though we can see as people that they're pretty strongly related, most things are the same. Most actions are going to have the same effect, and most things are going to work and the same in the world except for the block is. The algorithm isn't going to know that. It's going to have to explore all, like if it's doing RL, so it doesn't know the transition dynamics, it's going to have to figure out what all the transition dynamics are when the block's in this corner, and then it's going to have to figure out what all the transition dynamics are when the block's in the other corner. Okay, so it's going to dramatically increase the size of your sample space. And this problem is what people call the cursive dimensionality. So as you add more and more blocks into our system, this gets worse and worse and worse, right? So if I have one block, you know, it's already pretty bad. Like I'm not generalizing across the two blocks in the corner. If I have two blocks, it's even worse, right? Like so now the even though for us maybe it's not even there's no difference if block one is in the corner versus block two is in that corner. For the algorithm, that's completely different. Like it's going to have to learn that all over again. And if you give it even more blocks, which in Minecraft, you know, you have lots and lots and lots of blocks. You know, you can create new things and place them in different locations in the world. Then things really explode. And so the challenge, I think the number one challenge in RL, in research RL right now, reinforcement learning and MDPs, is how do you handle these types of state spaces? How do you handle the way things explode when you add more blocks to the world, when you are working in very large state spaces where, you know, or when you're working in continuous state spaces and then you have to discretize, how can you generalize across these different domains? So one way that we're looking at is sort of based on a couple of different things. So the first thing that we're thinking about is something called object-oriented MDPs. So this is something that Michael Littman and his students came up with a couple years ago. And basically the idea behind that is to factor the way that we represent the state action space based on objects. So if you come from like object-oriented programming or something, it seems like a pretty natural thing to do. To say that, well, if I have a block in the corner, it doesn't really matter which block it is, as long as I know it's a block. And you know, and like you could even have different kinds of blocks, like maybe blocks of sand versus blocks of rocks are different in Minecraft. But as long as I know it's a block of sand in the corner, I can generalize across different situations based on that knowledge. Or if I know that I'm sitting next to a block, you know, it doesn't matter if I'm over here next to a block or if I'm over here next to a block. Again, I can generalize. The same transition dynamics are going to happen in those situations. So the idea behind OMDPs is basically to work this out. So you can define the state space in terms of objects and their attributes, and then you get this compaction. So just automatically it'll know, as long as it's the same block, it's the same type of block, and it's in the same location, it'll only have one slot, one parameter to learn for how things, or more, I mean, it might be more than one because there's more than one action you can do with that block, but it'll generalize across these different objects. And they have a reinforcement learning algorithm that's modified to handle object-oriented MDPs, and they show that it works better than the tabular representation in their paper. So that's sort of one thing you can do. We're going to kind of survey over different things you can do to handle these types of problems. So another thing people have looked at is something called temporally extended actions. So does anyone want to guess what that, I think I talked about it last time too, does anyone want to guess what that means? Just the word temporally extended action. It sounds kind of jargony maybe. Anyone want to do it? Yeah.
Well, it seems like the actions go on for like longer times at a time. It seems like you have an initiation state and a termination state, like do while.
Yes, exactly. So an option, in particular, you have an initiation state or a set of states that says when you're allowed to start the option. And then you have a policy that's given to you. So you don't have to look it up. Like when you're running that option, you're running this predetermined policy. So remember, what's a policy? Yep.
It's a mapping from state to action.
Exactly. So I'm given this mapping that's associated with that option of from a state to an action, and then a termination state. So this is when I'm going to stop running the option and go back and you know, do whatever I was doing before in the low-level action space. So there's another variant of this which people call macro actions, which is even simpler. So a macro action is I'm not given a policy, I'm given a plan. So for a macro action, I'm going to close my eyes and I'm just going to do action 1, action 2, action 3, action 4, and then I'm going to stop. And I'm not going to look at, so even if I'm in a noisy domain and action, you know, 3 took me not somewhere I didn't expect to be taken, I'm just going to do it anyway and hope things work out. So it's simpler in some ways because you don't have to have the whole full-on policy, but it can get you into trouble because you might go off your script and take you somewhere you don't want to be. So people use both to get this kind of temporally extended behavior. So in Minecraft, and we're actually working on this right now, like trying to define some reasonable options for Minecraft, and we're thinking about things like building a staircase or making a house, or crafting different things by combining things together. So your low-level actions would be like picking things up and putting things down, maybe one crafting operation. So I don't want to use too much Minecraft jargon, but like, you know, so if you, who's played Minecraft before? Most of you. So crafting means combining different primitive things together, so you can make like a pickaxe or a crafting table or a sword to cut, because there's zombies. You have to defend yourself from the zombies. You can make a sword to protect yourself from zombies. So those might be options, and you can define. So a theme of a lot of these new things is you can define a new MDP in terms of the old things with a bigger state space and more complicated transition dynamics. So remember, with POMDPs, that was true, because we could define an MDP where the state space was the belief state. So the state space was really big, right, because it's continuous now. But it was still an MDP, and then we could apply some of our old ideas to solving it. So similarly, for options, you can do that. And the original options paper, which was probably 10 or 15 years ago now, does this. So they basically worked out the math for what value iteration looks like when you have options and prove that it's optimal. And you get a win because you can actually search more deeply in the state space without enumerating every single low-level action, because you can use these options. So you'll get faster convergence when you're running VI. Or if you're running RL, you might learn that this option's a good idea, and rather than having to like have the thing backward propagate through an entire chain of lower level actions. So that's sort of another way people have thought about structuring these kinds of problems with these hierarchical actions. So the third way that people have tried is something called subgoal. I'm not sure what to call it, but we're calling it subgoal planning. It's related to something in the textbook that's called partial order planning. So the basic idea is that you're going to first plan in the high level space. So find a policy or a subgoal that you're trying to reach in this high level space, and then find a policy in the low level space to go from subgoal to subgoal. So in our Minecraft example, a subgoal might be like, well, maybe I want to have a bridge, and I want to find the state where I have a bridge going across that trench. And that might be easier because I have a shorter sequence, so like I would define this as an MDP. Like, instead of giving myself reward for standing in the corner over here, I'm going to give myself reward for having a bridge. I'm going to give this additional information to the agent, and then it's going to solve that smaller MDP. And then once it's done that, I'm going to solve a different one where I'm standing here with a bridge and I don't have a block anymore, and I'm going to cross the bridge and get to the goal. So that can give you a win because you don't sort of faster convergence, basically, because you can find a good policy without having to go as deeply into the state space. So if you remember how in VI, like, things propagated back from where you got reward. So if the reward giving location is sooner in your sequence, then that propagation is going to happen faster, and you're going to know what to do faster. Okay. So this one was actually used in Minecraft by another group at MIT. This was so if you remember, we read Bronnevon's paper towards the beginning of the semester. He was making stuff that follows directions in Microsoft tech support articles. So you could read the article and then come up with actions in Windows. So this is a different paper that he wrote that learns to play Minecraft by reading the Minecraft wiki. So it's like reading text in the wiki. So here's some example text. The pickaxe, which is used to harvest stone, can be made from wood. So it's reading that text, and then it's inferring this subgoal graph. So it's given possible preconditions, like I could have stone, I could have a pickaxe, I could have wood, and it's not given these connections. These are kind of, you know, like they could exist, but they don't know which actual connections are really exist in the subgoal graph. And then after it learns that wood is a precondition for pickaxe, and pickaxe is a precondition for stone. And so then it can decide at a planning time that I'm going to first try to, if my goal is to have stone, like I would get a cookie if I have stone, I don't actually have to plan all the way through the low-level space to get stone. I can first try to get wood and do my low-level planning here, and then I can try to go from wood to having a pickaxe, and then I can go from a pickaxe to stone. If my sub-goals are good, that's going to help me a lot. So that's sort of this idea of sub-goal planning. So what I think, and there's sort of more ideas of things like this, but these seem to be the main ones as we're surveying the literature. And what I think about it, and what I think about it right now, is that these ideas of temporally extended actions and subgoals are complementary to each other. So like, you can have a temporally extended action And separately, you can have a sub-goal, and they can both help you in different ways to achieve your goal. So the temporally extended action is going to help you search more deeply in the state space, whereas this is going to help sort of filter your search. It's going to help stop you from having to search as deep in the first place. But there's one more thing that we are trying to add to this that we think is necessary to really prune things away so like in Minecraft, you can make really complicated things. You can make graphing calculators in Minecraft, right? So people have done this. So you can go on the internet and see these amazing videos of this guy. You can make a transistor out of, you know, pickaxes and wood and stone and stuff, and then you can actually put that together to make an adder, and then people have done it all the way to making a graphic calculator. You can walk around in it too. It's like, it's really cool. So the question is that we're trying to figure out is, how can we make agents that can make, like, people can do this? How can we make agents, robots and software agents, that can make things this big and this complicated, and without blowing up from the curse of dimensionality? And so the sort of the third thing that we think we need to add to make this work is something that we're calling affordances. So the idea behind an affordance is that we're going to reduce the size of the state action space by removing actions that aren't useful right now. And this builds, this is sort of useful when you have so the way that we define this is by what actions that aren't useful right now is defined in terms of what your current sub-goal is, and also in terms of what your current state is. So affordance basically says, if I am trying to move somewhere and I can move everywhere around me in my local space, I'm not going to try to place blocks anywhere. So I'm just going to prune away that whole question of, like, you know, is the block going to be in the corner over here or in the corner over here, and how do I generalize them? I'm not even going to think about it. I'm just not going to allow myself to place any blocks anywhere in the environment. And so what that does is combines with options and sub-goals in a really nice way, because one of the problems with options is that, go back to the options slide, is that as you add more options, in some ways your life gets worse, because you're giving yourself more things that you have to search over and figure out the value function for and think about, right? And that seems like sort of bad and also kind of counterintuitive. We're giving it more information, but it's somehow making the agent's life worse because it's got to learn about those new pieces of information. But with affordances, what it lets you do is also learn when, if you're giving yourself more high-level actions, you can learn when they're useful and when they're not useful. So not just the initiation set, which is like when you're even allowed to do it, whether it's possible to do it, but when it's a good idea, when it makes sense to try that option, depending on what your current goal is in the world right now. And similarly, for sub-goal planning, what we found is it's actually pretty tricky to define these sub-goals in a way that's general. So for our Minecraft world, when they were doing this paper, they were finding sub-goals that were true in every single Minecraft state space. So what I mean by that is, like, one of the sub-goals for Minecraft was that if I want to have bread, I need wheat. And no matter what you did, whether you had a graphing calculator or a pickaxe or a house or just a hole in the ground, that was always true. No matter what your Minecraft state space looked like, you always needed to have wheat before you could make bread, if that was something that you wanted to do. So these sub-goals were very general, and they worked across many different states. On the other hand, we looked at what we were calling these bridge problems here, where this guy is trying to cross a trench. A sub-goal might be, I want to have a block in a trench. But what we got stuck on, maybe you guys have ideas, is how we could define that sub-goal in a general way. So, like, for this particular example, I could totally define a sub-goal. I could say, well, right there, that's a good sub-goal. You can look at it and pick. This is what you should try to do to have it be a sub-goal to halfway along the trajectory. But it seems kind of arbitrary. I mean, somehow the trench, putting the block in the trench seems like a good idea, but why not just have the sub-goal be standing next to the trench? Or, you know, the state where you're standing on the block in the trench? And what's the difference between having a block here versus here versus here versus here? Any of them seem pretty good. So defining the sub-goal wasn't obvious. Like, which one is the right one? There's lots of ones that seemed good. And defining it in a way that's generalizable was also tricky. So like, what if, you know, our trench was one block over here? We'd have to somehow make a trench detector, it seemed like, to say, like, if there's a trench, and like, we'd have to write some code to say what that meant. And then your sub goal and your goal is to get across a trench. So what does even that mean? Like, you're trying to get across. Like, we had to run some kind of, we're thinking about running some kind of A star thing or something. And that was confusing. And then our sub goal would be to place the block in the trench. So we could kind of imagine it, but it just seemed like it involved perception. And that was scary. Like, perception is like the idea of identifying what trenches are, what these higher level things are, and then generalizing them across different states. It seemed kind of scary. So we decided that sub-goal planning wouldn't help you in these situations. But affordances, it turned out we could come up with a nice way to filter the state space here. So what we defined the affordances in this domain as is if you want to move and you can move in all the cells around you, don't think about placing blocks. On the other hand, if you want to move and you're standing next to some place where you can't move, like a trench, and that's something we could test in a pretty natural and general way, like, is movable, is the place in front of me movable? So this was building on top of an OMDP, so you would get that generality sort of for free. Not for free, because they had to do a lot of work to get OMDPs. But then think about placing blocks. On the other hand, if you're standing next to a wall and you're trying to move somewhere, think about destroying things. You know, get out your pickaxe and try to whack down that wall. So what we did was defined a set of affordances for Minecraft and showed that when you combined it with sub-goal planning, life is really good. Like, you actually are able to dramatically speed up the performance of a planner, of a value iteration planner that we just talked about last time, because it's directly pruning the state action space. And our current goal right now is to plug this in with options. So we think that with options, you can add as many high-level actions as you want. And as long as you add affordances to say when they're a good idea, when they're a bad idea, you're not going to pay a penalty for it, because you're gonna learn, or you're gonna know when this is good and when this is bad. So all of these approaches. Does anything bother you about what I've said so far? Yeah.
Well, you said you guys combined it with sub-goal planning.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
in different domains, we were able to, some goals are really natural. Like, if I want, like, we want to make ore, I want to make metal, I have to have ore, and I have to have a smelter.
Oh,
so we actually did that.
More complicated.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Yeah, maybe I'll show the video next time of it doing this like, kind of complicated domain where it's like opening doors and, you know, knocking down walls and planning in these larger state spaces. Does anything bother you about what I've said so far? Yeah.
I mean, it kind of seems like you just have to hard code all.
Yeah,
the
exactly. So what we're doing to make this work is hard coding everything. We're hard coding the affordances. We're hard coding the sub goals. Even though we're trying to do it in a general way, we're trying to do the affordances in a general way. We're hard coding the sub goals, and when we're going to do options next, and we're going to hard code the options too. We're going to define them based on what we as humans think would be good ideas for encoding these things. So what's wrong with doing that?
It's not generalizable.
Yeah, we as humans aren't really good at doing that. Right, like we're not good at coming up with generalizable sub-goals and options and macro actions in these very complex domains. And so the thing that we're going to do next is sort of this sort of theme of this little mini unit of the course. It's like, we started out giving the system knowledge of the transition model and the dynamics. We're giving it knowledge of the options, the sub-goals, and the affordances, and we're demonstrating that things do better. The next thing we're going to try to do is learn all of those three things. So for the sub-goal planning, there's this other paper that can already show how to learn it. For options, it's interesting, like, if you look at the history of it, the original options paper just gave it the options. So they said, here's how to do value iteration if you have options. And I'm not going to tell you where they come from. You just have them, and you have to hope they're good. And more recently, George Coney Darris did a PhD thesis at UMass Amherst where he focused on learning options. And there's a bunch of work where people try to learn good temporally extended actions that try to sort of chunk the state space in a way that makes sense for some definition of sense. So there's a lot of work in that kind of thing with varying degrees of success. And and the sort of challenge of it is that you have, again, is coming back to generality. So like I can do it for one domain, but if I want to go from one Minecraft world to another Minecraft world and have my options still work, or even more generalized, people want to work on going from like Minecraft to Doom to a real robot, like, you know, completely different game versus a completely different domain, and have these things somehow kind of generalize. And what that means is sort of up for, like, as you get more and more generalizable, sometimes things get more and more sketchy. But it's sort of an interesting thing to think about how you can make these things super generalizable. So sort of our sort of research program right now in this area is we're trying to learn affordances. So we're going to try to implement an algorithm that learns affordances in an RL kind of way. So we'll talk about, you know, RL next. We want to get some code, like we'll probably take one of the existing papers that learns options and one of the existing papers that learns, I misspelled it, that learns subgoals. And then, like, we're going to try and learn them all at the same time. So it's basically directly address this problem that you were raising so that we can have this agent learn the structure of the environment and learn to plan really fast in a way that respects that sort of gets you out of the curse of dimensionality. So we'll see how well it works. You can check back in another year or two and ask me how it's going. But I wanted to give you a flavor of like one approach of how to address this. And also, maybe this is, you know, one of the reasons I'm doing this research is because it's something that bothered me about the MDP and RL literature. I felt like it was just ignoring these problems of the tabular representation. So I want to say there is work that's trying to address them. And a lot of it builds on the ideas we're going to be talking about. So don't throw out the baby with the bathwater when we go back to the tabular representation and stuff. Have faith that there, you know, we're trying to figure out better ways to do it. And there are also, we're going to also talk today about linear function approximation, which is another way to get this kind of generalization. Okay, so that was kind of a research digression. So here's our value iteration algorithm from last time. So RL is kind of like you have an MDP, so states, actions, a transition model, and a reward. And if I know the transition model, so to remind you, the transition model is I'm going to give a state and an action. It's going to give me a distribution over next states. And I know the reward function, so either a state or a state and an action, and it gives me a real number. I know that. I can ask about any state I want. I can get the reward function back out. Then I can go back and do value iteration and find a policy that maximizes my reward. And I could execute it and get lots of cookies and avoid getting bopped on the head, and my agent will be very happy. In reinforcement learning, I'm going to take away these two pieces. So they exist out in the world. Like I'm going to assume that there's some generating process that's going to, when I take an action, is going to somehow take me to the next state, but I don't get to know what it is. So I'm going to take an action, and for all I know, I could be teleported to China afterwards. the agent at the beginning has no idea what the effects of its own actions are. And similarly, it doesn't know its reward function. So I could take an action and maybe I'll get a really big cookie and maybe I will get bopped on the head really hard. Before the agent takes the action at the beginning of time, it has no idea which of those two things is going to happen. Okay? And the goal is over time to try to learn how to behave better in the domain, to maximize your like in MDP, you could do discounted reward, or you're in a finite domain, you could do non-discounted reward. And there's other things you could try to maximize. You could talk about average reward and stuff like that. Mostly, we'll talk about discounted reward because the math works out the nicest in that case. So my goal again is to maximize my reward, but I don't even know what my reward function is. So as I'm wandering around in the world, eventually, I want to learn how to behave in a way that gets me cookies. Okay, so how do you guys think we should do this? What are some different ways? What are some different things we could try to learn to make this happen?
And you can just kind of learn the transition function.
Yeah. So I could learn
in the state space.
Transition function from samples. And then what else would I need to learn if I was going to do this?
The reward
function, yeah. And also reward function. And once I have those, what do I need to do if I want to act in a wise way?
Isn't it just what we were doing before?
Exactly, yeah. So once I have the transition function and the reward function, then I have to do, so I guess this sort of step one, and then step two, do VI or something. There's other things you can do to solve the MDP. Now I have both those things because I've learned them, or I have estimates of them. To solve the MDP and then try to get cookies. Is that the only thing I could do? Is there any other ideas for things we could try to do to do this? Yeah.
Well, while you're doing VI, you might learn more stuff about your transition model or your reward function.
So VI is going to estimate your utility, right? Given any particular transition and reward function, that uniquely defines the utility of the state, right? The expected discounted reward of being in that state, right? And then I use the utility to get me a policy. So what else could I learn? So one thing I could do is learn the transition function and the reward function, and then solve the MDP to get the utilities that those are defined as, and then I could use that to get a policy.
Right, while you're doing your policy, you might learn something about the environment, or your environment might change.
We're going to assume the environment doesn't change, except for in the way, the state space is how my environment changes. If I want to encode that, I would, like in Minecraft, I would have new states for having blocks in different places. But I'm going to assume that the transition function does not change over time. I think there is some work where that people break that, but we're not going to do that. That would break our Markov assumption. I'm going to try to see if somebody else wants to say something. So what else could we learn? We talked about some of this last time, about we really only want to figure out how to act in the world, right? So do we really need to know the transition function and the reward function to figure out how to act? Okay. No, good. So what can we do instead? Yeah?
Keep track of what has been rewarded for what particular courses of action you've taken.
Yeah. Right. So that's right. So we can keep track. So that's one way. Keep track of return or reward, I'll say reward, I want to try to get that, reward for different courses of action. So what does that really correspond to learning? So if we go back to like our VI algorithm, I think I have it up here. What is the return for doing different courses of action? How can we encode that?
Isn't that essentially what the utility is?
Exactly, yes. That's a utility function. So our utility, so here is U of the state, but we're also going to talk about Q, which is the utility of being in a state and taking a particular action, is the expected discounted reward for being in that state. So I could, instead of trying to learn the transition function and the reward function, I could learn U or Q. And then once I have that, what do I need to do to actually get a policy? Yep.
Wait, what is Q again?
Q, we'll talk, let's see. I have it ahead. So Q is this. So utility is the expected discount reward of being in that state. Q is the expected discounted reward of being in that state and taking a certain action. So here's the definition of U in terms of Q. If I have a Q, I take the best action and then I get a U. Okay? Okay. Okay. So I could learn speed lecture, right? So I could learn U or a Q. And then what do I have to do? Let's just say it's you. What do I have to do then to get a policy? can look at VI. If I have my utility. Yep.
Then you just want to maximize it?
Yeah, I choose the action that maximizes my expected utility. Maximizes Q or U. And it'll be, if it's U, it'll be an onexpectation over my distribution of next states. I'm going to choose the action that maximizes the distribution over future states. If it's Q, I can just do it directly. Okay, so that's great. So, and when I say learn, like I haven't said how we're going to learn it. There's lots of ways we could learn those things. So one way is sort of the tabular representation. So I could just keep counts for every state and every action. I could keep a count of the transit and the times that that action took me to one state versus another state. I could keep a count of the rewards that I got. And then assume assume it's some kind of multinomial distribution or something and get an estimate. For this, I can again keep we'll talk about how to do it, but you can basically keep track of the reward that you get and backwards propagate it using something that looks like this update in VI. And we're actually going to code it up, so I'll make that concrete later. Okay, so there's one more thing we could do, or we could learn, that we'll talk about. Does anybody have any ideas about what else we could do? Yeah?
Could you maybe just directly map states to actions?
Yeah, so we could just directly map states to actions. So the sort of third thing we could do is called, I'll just call it sort of policy search. So I'm going to try to learn some function f of s that returns something in my action set. And I'm going to try to find the function that maximizes my return. Okay? So I'm not going to bother with the transition function or the reward function at all. I'm not going to bother with the utility function at all. I'm just going to learn something that makes a decision about what actions to take. So this was kind of like in our machine learning world, this is kind of like a generative model where we're going to think a lot about how we're going to make some assumptions about the domain, about the transition model and how things work, and we're going to optimize our model parameters, and then once we've got the model, we're going to solve things. This is also still kind of like a generative model, but it's assuming less things about the domain. So we're not actually going to go and work out these different parameters of the reward function and the transition function. We're not going to make assumptions about that structure. We're just going to try to directly estimate the return that we're going to get from different states and then use that to come up with a policy. This is sort of the SVM way of thinking about it. I'm not going to worry about making distributions over things. I'm not going to worry about trying to estimate parameters of the different domains. I'm going to just try to find this function f, whatever it is. And typically, when people do this, they'll assume that f is from a class of different policies. So you might assume that I'm going to draw my action from based on some sum of weighted features, and I'm going to learn the feature weights. So I'm going to try to find good feature weights, and that would be like argmaxing over theta of the sum of my features and hope that that gives me a good policy. People use this a lot for robot control, so they'll in continuous spaces, so they'll use kind of complicated control basis vectors to give you that sort of combine different control strategies in a linear way, and then they'll learn the different weights of how to make this work. What's a problem with this? This is also what Branovan did in that paper we read about Microsoft Tech Support articles. He was doing policy gradient to do these updates. What's the problem with this?
States could be really big, and interaction states could be really big, so like the power set, or the whatever that's called.
Yeah, so...
Cross product of two.
Yeah, I have to make a decision about the space of, in any of these, I have to make a decision about the space of functions I'm going to be searching over. So for policy search, if I pick the true space of functions, it's going to be so big I'm going to be in trouble. It's going to be back to this tabular representation, and things are going to be really sad. On the other hand, if I pick a space that's smaller, it's easier to search because it's smaller. But what's the problem if it's too small? Or if it's big but I pick a bad one, doesn't match.
It might not find a good mapping.
Yeah, there just might not be any policy in the space that gives me a good return. So it turns out there that navigating this world is a delicate art, because you have to pick the right policy space. It also is susceptible to local maxima. So if I pick a good space, it might be there somewhere in the space. But if I do a gradient-based method, you'll do some kind of stochastic gradient descent often, you might get stuck somewhere. Like, there might be a really good policy somewhere else, and you're stuck at a local maxima. So there's sort of a limit to how good things can get. That said, for lots of applications, especially the robotics applications, it's a good trade-off. So people have been able to find effective subspaces of the policy space. They've been able to define good spaces of F to search over, and some of the coolest results in RL are done using policy-based methods. So we're going to talk more about that in the next classes. But I kind of wanted, it's actually kind of cool that you guys elicited the main different branches of RL and the different ways people can do it. And carrying out these different strategies, like, there's lots of twists and turns you can take along the way. And that's kind of what leads to the alphabet soup of different things you can do. And just like in machine learning, there's some ideas about which ones are better when. And like with policy search, people know that people have had a lot of success with this in robotics. But there's not like a concrete guidance about what you should use in any particular situation. If you talk to somebody who really knows all these algorithms really well, often you'll get a non-determinative answer about what algorithm you should use when. It's hard to figure it out. It's hard to navigate through this space. It's again related to the fact that this is kind of an emerging, I won't say emerging research area. It's probably 15 or 20 years old now, but it's a research area that hasn't yet found its killer app, I guess, is what I'll say. We haven't yet really gotten our heads as computer scientists around the right way to think about these problems. On the other hand, I think it's really exciting because it's sort of the ultimate AI problem. Like, you're just trying to go out and choose good actions, and it's a nice way to formalize it. So I do want to talk a little bit about applications of this kind of technology. So we did this zip through. This is showing a policy search algorithm that was training this AIBO. This is a robotic dog to walk, and this is so a lot of times, because policy search algorithms start out with are susceptible to local minima and maxima problems, they need to be initialized in a good way. So you have to initialize it with something that can actually walk to get it to do anything. But then after it learns, it'll learn a policy that looks better. It's not like this dramatic, oh my gosh, it's so much better kind of improvement. But you can kind of see this guy's kind of tripping, and this gait is much smoother and much faster. And that's done by using these kind of policy search methods. Another place people have used RL to good effect is in game playing. So the best backgammon player and the best Go player, computer Go player, were both trained using RL-based methods and temporal difference learning methods. So the way that this system worked is it used RL to learn the evaluation function, which is really the utility function, right? Like this estimate of the value of being in different states. So it was doing a minimax algorithm with a two-step look ahead to play, but the way that it decided which state was how good the leaves of that tree after the two-step look ahead were was this function, this evaluation function that it tuned by playing itself. So basically there'd be lots of computer cycles where two versions of TD Gammon, that was the name of the algorithm, would play each other, and it would learn different ways of evaluating those different states. And it's competitive with the best human players, and it turns out that they actually introduced new backgammon strategies to human play. So there were backgammon strategies that people didn't know about before this algorithm existed, and because it was playing itself, it wasn't limited to the strategies people were using. And so it just sort of tried everything from a blank slate, and there was new strategies that it found that actually have since gone into competitive play. Like, people saw, oh, I didn't think that was a good move, but actually that's the best move I could do. in certain situations. And this algorithm was able to learn that. Another one I think is pretty cool, going back to the robotics, and you guys are going to do this in your project, is something called the inverted pendulum. So the idea is you have this little cart, and you're trying to move the cart to keep the stick, it's like a hinge here, to keep the stick balanced up on one end. So it's like balancing I can't really do it, but like balancing a marker on your hand by moving your hand around in the right way, right? Only I just dropped it. And the way that, so this is a continuous domain, and when you simulate it, it's going to observe Newtonian mechanics, so it's going to move in sort of this frictionless world where things fall with gravity and 9.8 meters per second squared and all that stuff. And your job is to try to keep it upright. And we'll discretize the action space in your project. So you guys get to choose to, it's called bang-bang control. You can either move it left, and we'll stick that into the Newtonian mechanics as a fixed force to the left that you get to apply, or a fixed force to the right that you get to apply. And the state space, so again, it's continuous. You have x, x dot, theta, and theta dot, so your angular velocity and your angular position and your x position and your x velocity. And we'll discretize the state space as well. So we'll just make, I would like to say that we'll just make bins, and then, you know, if x is between 0 and 0.1 and x dot is between 0 and 0.1 and theta is between 90 and 95, that's state one, and it'll just kind of go like that, and it's kind of in this very uninformed way. When I tried to code up inverted pendulum in that way, it didn't work at all. And it only started working when I downloaded the RL books code for inverted pendulum that broke up the state space in a very strange and hand-coded way, right? So they basically had a lot more bins around the center where things could kind of go south really fast, and a lot fewer bins when the pendulum was already falling down. And they did this in a way where you could tell that they had messed with it by hand, like they hadn't actually learned it. So that was kind of sad, actually, because it was like, this is like one of the standard benchmark problems for RL, and I was sad to see that they had to define the state space manually. But it's also, I think, instructive because it comes back to some of the tweaking that you have to do to make these things work reliably in practice. So this is some, I'm going to show you guys a video of a modern inverted pendulum algorithm. And this is actually training in real time. So this is like all of the training data that this guy sees. He's trying to learn how to balance the pendulum. It's given a reward function. So they define the reward function in advance, and it's observing how much reward it gets. You know, not much right now, as it randomly moves its little guy around. So here's resetting. I think this is also using a policy search-based method with features that generalize across different states. So the amazing thing about this, like when I saw this video a couple years ago, I was just floored because it happens so fast. So like, you know, he's showing you that it's had, you know, 7.5 seconds, you know, in very little training time. Yeah. So now it's actually, but see, this is kind of cool. Like it's actually learning to get it up, even if it hasn't learned to stop. It's sort of, you know, going to these different places in the space. Whoa. So it's kind of getting it, right? Like it's balancing and then it got back stuck. Whoa. Which, yeah. So sometimes people assume it's on an infinite track. It's harder if it's only allowed to move in certain directions. It's got to be better, or it hits the wall. Whoa! So you can see it's noticeably better every single time as it's getting its training. He must have got distracted. So basically, it got it, and then they knock it. Like, you know, let's give it some pain. And it's actually able to, you know, balance that after about 17, 20 seconds or so of training. So it's kind of amazing when you see it happening on a real thing, like, you know. The video stopped. So it's kind of amazing, like, and that's the promise of RL, like, right? Like that we can actually have algorithms do that, like just learn, give it the reward function, and then learn what to do to keep something like that balanced. People have done it learning to walk. There's some really cool helicopter videos that they did at Stanford. Maybe you've seen them, where it learns how to fly a helicopter inverted and like do the whole aerial show of RC helicopters. So like, you know, TikTok and all these crazy tricks that people do with them. And it can learn these kinds of control strategies. Yes?
So if you're giving it the reward function, why is it still reinforcement learning? Because this just sounds like what we're doing.
Yeah, so you're not giving it the reward function. It's tricky. Like you have to be precise about what you know and what you don't know and what does it mean to know. So by giving it the reward function, what he had to do, what Mark Dizenroth had to do, was encode something that for every particular state that this guy, this pendulum could be in, has to return a real number. So you can imagine like a C program or Python program that takes as input the x dot, the theta dot, and gives you a reward. You know, maybe plus one if it's you know over the top, and minus one if it's not. Or you might imagine giving it a bigger penalty the more it's displaced. What you're not giving it is the ability. You're not giving the algorithm the ability to ask for values of that reward function for any state and any action that it wants. So it cannot iterate through all the states and all the actions and find out the reward. Instead, it has to actually go and experience that in the world. And so it gets these trajectories, which it has to use some strategy on the board of estimating what the reward function is over time. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Since you're like providing it the reward function, or like you're not providing it the reward function, but you could if you wanted to, right?
Yeah. So it's sometimes easier to provide it in a way where you just sort of look at the current state of the world and see how, like in this domain, you could if you wanted to, like you could enumerate through all the states and all the actions, and give it the reward function. However, it might be the case, like so something that might be the case in this domain is like if you discretize your state action space and try to do one of these two techniques, it would still take a really long time, right? Because you have to go through every single bin of xx dot theta and theta dot and do your value iteration. Versus if you're able to get experiences in the world, it might turn out that you only need to actually explore a small fraction of that state space to get a good estimate for the policy, and you might be able to do much better. It also might be the case that it's hard to come up with the reward function in a way where you can iterate through all the states. But it's easy to do it if you actually are in a particular real situation. So maybe your reward function is whether the person is smiling at you or not. Okay? People have written face detectors and they've written emotion recognition algorithms. So they're actually systems that can look at a face and decide whether or not they're smiling and give you a cookie or a spot on the face if you're frowning, let's say. However, you cannot know in advance of actually being in that environment whether the person's smiling or frowning. Does that make sense? So it might really be stochastic, like you can detect it, but you can't actually encode it in a way where you can iterate through all the states in the actions. We look at these problems because they're models of that. So the application, I forget if it was you or somebody else suggested last time, of web search and figuring out what ads people click on. You want your reward function is they clicked on the ad. You know, and you can know for sure when they did it, and for sure when they didn't do it, for any particular sequence of states that they follow through your website. But you can't know in advance, like offline, without actually getting a person to play with your website. You can't know in advance what that reward function would be. That's another example.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Okay. All right. So inverted pendulum. So this is sort of connecting, so like there's another distinction that we can make in RL when we're doing these learning things. So one is that we can do something that's called off policy. So I can run some random policy, like let's say I'll just pick actions randomly and collect data from the environment about what's going on, and then I can learn any of these things. I guess I couldn't do this. I could learn either of these two things. And then later on, I'll try out that policy and see how much reward it got. Or I could do active learning, and people call it on policy, where I get to pick my actions as I explore the environment, and I get to update myself, basically, as I learn. And this can be good because you can sort of bias yourself, especially in these really high branching factor spaces. If I'm doing like a completely random learner, I might spend most of my time in that Minecraft domain, you know, exploring what happens if I place blocks in the corner, even though that has nothing to do with crossing the trench, versus an on-policy algorithm. As it starts to learn, it's going to use that to bias where it is in the state space. And that'll let it put more energy and more samples and more resources into the parts where that look promising, that seem to give a good reward. So we're going to, as our example, we're going to go back to this grid world domain. And we're going to take away the transition matrix and the reward matrix, and then make a reinforcement learning agent that basically learns what to do. I take off my appears. So this is going to come back to the Bellman equation. So this is, again, from last time, the utilities of the state is the reward plus the maximum action that maximizes your expected utility in the next state, right? And then this is recursive, so that actually goes all the way back to your goal state. It kind of encodes the future in itself, but in a way where you only have to look at one utility in the future. It collapses the future into this one number, if that makes sense. So we can do this. So what we can do is, starting with the Bellman equation, we can do an update of utility over time. And this is called temporal difference learning. So I can basically say that there's this relation that has to hold for my utility. If I take the utility of the current state, and then I look at the utility in the next state, and the reward that I got when I went to the next state, they should be related by the discount factor, by the reward that I got in that state. Does that make sense? So like if I jump to the next state and I get a reward, then the utility of the next state should be related to the utility of the last state less the reward that I just got. Because the utility of where I am right now is sort of this estimate of everything in the future. So there's this local relation that has to hold between utilities of two adjacent states. So this update here is sort of encoding this relation. So I'm going to take the utility of my next state plus the reward I got in this state minus my utility in my current state is an error function of this. It's called the temporal difference error. So this part here is the difference in what I should have gotten, what the relation between these two utilities should be, because it's sort of adding the reward versus what it actually is in my lookup table. Does that make sense? This idea of TD error is used in lots and lots of different algorithms. So the idea behind temporal difference learning is I'm going to take this error term, I'm going to multiply it by some small number, so I'm not going to believe any one sample for too much. And then I'm going to issue a correction to my utility estimate in the current state. So I'm going to just knock it up a little bit in the direction of this TD error. So this looks kind of like the update that I'm doing in value iteration, where I'm feeding the utilities from the next state back through the algorithm and the utilities of the previous state. But here, instead of doing it over all the states inside of a for loop, I'm just going to take the current state that I got and do a kind of local update. In terms of my utilities. So pi is the current policy that's induced by that utility. So there's an algorithm in the book for this, which basically encodes this update in a kind of nice way. So once we've done this, how do we, and we've got our use, how do we use that? Yeah.
So is this a form of the second?
Yes.
One here?
Yes, I'm going to learn you. And next we'll talk about why, well, what we're going to talk about now is why the problem with this approach. So how do we use, and then now that'll motivate why we need to do queues, or what the advantage of queues are. versus use. So once I do this, how do I use that learned policy? What do I have to do? So I have my utility, and I got to pick an action. How do I pick the action?
The one that maximizes
utility. Pick the one that maximizes my expected utility. Okay. So how do I compute that expectation? Yep.
The utility of a state times the probability of
being in that state if I take that action. So what's that? I think I have that up here. Yeah. So that's this. That's how I compute an action. So what's this? That's the transition function. So in order to use this TD error with U, I also have to learn the transition function. Okay? So, and I could do that by counting things up and stuff like that to actually get back to a policy with U. And people do that. Like there's a version of this algorithm in the book that updates itself based on the transition function. But there's kind of a trick you can play where instead of, so here's the slide we zipped ahead to earlier in the lecture, where instead of learning U, we can learn Q. So Q, the Q function is the utility of being in a particular state and taking an action. So this is how it's defined. Like, so once I have Qs, I can get Us. How do I go the other way if I want to get Qs from Us?
By taking an action, do you mean, let's say I want to go up, mm-hmm. Is it actually like trying to go up, or is it like going up and going up, or like?
It's one single action. So I'm in the state at 0, 2, and I'm going to take the action that goes up, and that's going to have a utility. Defined in this way. So the utility of that action, of taking the utility of all the actions, I take the max, that gives me the sort of overall utility of being in that state. Because remember, utilities, I'm in this state, I'm going to act optimally afterwards. I'm going to take the optimal policy. So if I want to go backwards from this, I need the transition function, because I have to compute the sort of outcome of Q that's going to put me in different other states to give me the utility function. But if I have Q, I can just do it. I can just argmax over the action, because I'm just going to assume I'm acting optimally, and everything will be good. So it turns out you can basically do this. So this is sort of the Bellman equation for Q instead of U. And you can work out to get an update function that looks pretty similar. So this is, again, the TD error, R of S plus Q minus of my next state minus my Q of the current state, and I multiply by a learning rate. But to use this, so it's the same update with you know, two, like there's some changes to make it work with states and actions. But once I've got a Q, I don't actually need to estimate the transition matrix. It's just Q, and then I can use that to get a policy. So are there more parameters in Q or in U?
Q.
In Q, yeah. So it's not like a free lunch. There's no free lunch, right? I didn't need to estimate. There's fewer parameters here, but I also needed to get this transition matrix. But when you do this, you get this really simple form of learning, which people call Q learning. And this algorithm says I'm going to do something in the world. I'm going to maintain my Q, and every time I'm going to do one of these little updates, I'm going to not Q in the best direction, and then I'm going to return the action that I should take based on that. So then the book does this stuff with ends and counts. So I kind of skipped over this, but there's this idea of exploration versus exploitation. So if I am estimating my Q, how do I pick actions? It's the same. There's not a trick question. It's the same as before, right?
It doesn't depend if you're doing passive or.
It's the same. I'm doing active.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm estimating Q, and then I'm going to pick an action, right? I'm going to go argmax over my action. I think I have this here. So this is with U still. I'm going to argmax over my actions to get the policy. At the beginning, my Qs are all zero, right? So what happens if I always argmax with my current estimate of Q? I might get stuck in like a cycle of sadness, right? Where I have this bad policy, and the policy doesn't it sends me off into a trench and I just always go there and I never learn about the plus one reward somewhere else and things never feed back through and give me good reward. I never learn anything. So this kind of idea of greedily following your best estimate leads you into a trench. Like it will often not lead to the optimal policy, and it provably won't, and in some domains definitely won't. So what you have to decide as when you're doing RL is how to make this trade-off between exploring your world, so trying actions that you haven't tried before, that you've only tried a few times, versus exploiting what you've already known. So like once you have a lot of experience, you don't want to waste your time. You know, we already know there's trenches over there and there's a big cookie over here. You should just try to go and get the cookie as much as possible. And there's a lot of angst about this in RL. There's a theory of Bayesian RL that says how to optimally make this trade-off based on your tolerances for doing the wrong thing and completely exploring the domain. But what we're gonna and the book has this kind of weird. I tried to implement it and couldn't get it working. Of counting up how many times you've been in the different states and keeping track of that. I did something, what people do more frequently in the code we're going to do next, I did something a lot simpler, which is called epsilon greedy. So epsilon greedy is sort of a default way of solving this trade-off, where you just say, well, 10% of the time I'm going to pick randomly, and 90% of the time I'm going to take my best action for my best estimate. And people get along, epsilon greedy is really hard to beat. So there's all this bookkeeping, basically, that you can do with counting. So this N in the book is counting up how many times you're in that state in action, and then biasing your policy here. So this F function is sort of deciding whether to explore versus exploit based on how many times you were in a particular state. I just didn't bother with all that in the code, so we're going to do an epsilon greedy strategy instead. So, all right. So here is our Q-learning thing. So what we're going to do first is, so here's our little guy. Can everybody see? This is the same grid world that we had before with the green reward up here. The red is the minus one. This is the wall. And the circle there is where the agent currently is. And every time I hit enter, it's going to take an action randomly. So let's find that. So here it's going to randomly pick an action, and then it's going to move to the next state following the transition matrix. So it's going to sample a state. And of course, in this world, we actually know the transition matrix, so it's going to programmatically do this. In the real, like the inverted pendulum world, it might not know that transition dynamics. So like for the inverted pendulum, it's actually getting that from what the robot actually does. And then we're going to do an update. In this case, we're not going to do an update. We're going to say Q of SA AI equals 0. And then it's going to keep going. And then we're going to print the U. So I think I still have. This is the value iteration result. So this is sort of the optimal values, knowing from VI of what things are supposed to be. So if I just run it, you'll see this little guy kind of bouncing around. Sometimes he stays where he is because he's trying to go into the wall, and that's sort of what happens. And eventually he gets to the goal. So I didn't actually make it print anything. Let me make it bigger. And so it's going to, oh, I see, he's stuck in this corner here. So it kind of stuck because I wonder why it's not moving. Oh, I think I stopped drawing after that. So we're not seeing the update that happened. So let me just do that again. So every time I hit enter, he's going to try to move up and succeed maybe or not succeed. So he's moving left, moving right. That succeeded, so he moved over. Moving up, that caused a random error going the other direction. So we're just randomly picking policies, and then we're observing the reward. And then he went back, so I stopped drawing it. But the iteration here, the total reward earned of this, it actually made it to the plus one goal, but it got the minus 0.04 from all the bouncing around that it did. And so it only gets 0.56 reward. Okay, so we are running short on time. So maybe I'll just go pull the the update from my backup slide. But basically, it's the same update that we had on the board. So we're going to take my current estimate. I'm going to have a learning rate, which is typically you set it to be small. If you set it to be too big, you're going to be too dependent on the whims of what just happened to you. So you kind of want to have it be small so you don't change too much in case you got really unlucky for a current run. Times the reward plus the discount factor times the max. So this is over of my current of my next state that I'm in over all actions minus the current Q value. So this is computing the TD error here, and then this is knocking my Q for that cell in that direction. So I'm going to do it again, and we'll see what the update looks like. So here we kind of go around. I think it's actually not drawing the, let me print it out. So here's the Q matrix, and you can see it's getting updated. So this is minus 0.04 because it got that reward for its first time. And we're going to go, like, so you can sort of see things being filled in this matrix as it explores the space. So here I'm showing just one example, and we're getting all this, you know, these information about what to do. Somewhere, here we go. So here's where it got the plus one reward. And that's getting filled in for taking that. I think it went right in that state. It got plus one reward, but the learning rate's really small, so that plus one was 0.01 in this Q matrix. Does that make sense? Okay. So what do we need to do to make this work better? Like this is what's that?
Run it more times.
Run it more times. Exactly. So we're gonna do that now. So what I am going to do is take out the raw inputs. We don't have to hit enter every single time. And tell it, let's see. It's going to do every 50 iterations, it's going to draw its current policy. And I'm going to tell it, I'm going to make epsilon not 1. So I'm going to tell it to be 0.01. So it tries to follow the policy most of the time. I could also run it with 0.1, with 1, and it'll just randomly explore and update my queues. So let's see what that does. So it's thinking. So here's the one where it draws. And this is showing the reward over time. So it's like every 25 rewards averaged together. And the error bar is the standard deviation of this. So again, you can see, so this is 0.3. So it's getting up towards that value that we saw in value iteration. And then as that one goes up, the nearby ones go up too, right? Because they're feeding back. The TD error is bigger, so that's going to push the utility estimates up. So just like in value iteration, how it got pushed backwards through the state space, things kind of go up and up and up and up. So it takes a while because this is another typical thing of RL algorithms and papers is you run it and run it and run it and run it and you know things are very slow as it goes. So eventually it's going to stop and then we'll sort of see the optimal policy that it infers. But you can already kind of see from up here, like simulating it in your heads kind of that you'll. It's sort of learning that this is a good idea, this is a less good idea, right? As it's exploring down there, yeah.
Is the two like end states zero because they're end states? Like
yeah, so it's so the terminal states, so it's not estimating anything for them. Okay. The reward that it gets, so here it's gonna actually let me go through and see the action that I picked. So it's picking, moving up. Oh, it's not working. I wonder if my epsilon is still wrong. Oh yeah, it is. So I'm actually always acting. That's why my reward wasn't going down. My epsilon is being ignored. So let me pull that in so we see that. So here's epsilon greedy exploration. Instead of random.choice, If my random number is less than epsilon, I'm going to pick randomly. Otherwise, I'm going to do Q optimal. So now we'll see, instead of this staying flat, it's going to actually get less reward.
We get less reward?
I get more reward. The R is going to go down.
Okay.
It's going to go. All right. So you can see that it was working from the utilities, but it wasn't actually executing that policy. The other thing to note is if we compare this to VI estimate, the utility of this state is actually pretty good, right? Like it's close to the goal, even if it could go down there. But because our exploration policy is most of the time biasing it towards this optimal trajectory of going up, it doesn't have, so here we can see it's kind of, it is good. Okay, so it's doing this policy of going up and around to get to the goal. This estimate are wrong, right? They're much lower than they should be of the true utility because it's sort of focusing on the parts of the state space where it gets the most error. And to finish up, you can see here the reward is going up over time and your error bars are getting smaller. Okay, sorry for running a little bit over, and let me know if you have any questions. Thank you.